Okay, this is your first unit. RDBM is an Oracle. First unit is about database concepts, and the textbook used is Database System Using Oracle. Author is Nilesha. So the contents that you are going to see in this first unit is you are going to see about the introduction of database and the concepts that occur in the database and the most important is relational approach and the relationship that exists between that relational approach and what is meant by DBMS and the relational data model existence and integrity rules. These are the contents that we are going to see in today's class. Data means they are called as simply raw facts. So it will represent only dummy value or dummy data. You cannot able to come to a conclusion about what it is. So like those raw facts that are called as data. For example, if you take an example for this number, if you take, it may indicate a birthday or it may indicate a bank account number or it may indicate a customer membership number or it may indicate a telephone number. It may indicate among any four. This number may denote anything. You don't know now what it does represent. That representation is called as data. You have only raw facts in your hand. So before entering into database, you must understand the difference, basic difference between what is data and what is information. So with this raw facts, we can't do anything. So we have to process this particular raw data. That process is called as the information. Processed data is called as the information. So whenever you get the raw data as input and you process it, it will give you the output as information. As you saw in the previous slide, you take the same example 2906-2020. If you process this particular data, you may get an information like it may denote a birthday, that is 29th June 2020. It may indicate a birthday or it may indicate a date and it may indicate a value in the balance sheet. Or it may indicate some registration number by denoting the word R on that number. Or it may indicate an PIN code number, anything. It may indicate anything. So processing this particular data will give you information. Simply if it is the raw fact, mean those raw factors called as the data. Processed data, you call it as information. That's what here you will see if the data has been, it is called as the raw facts. If it is information, you will say that the data has been processed, manipulated, collected, and organized data. And database means collection of logically interrelated data. This is an important definition. Based on this data and based on this information, logically interrelated data is called as the database. It is also called as the electronic store of data. Next is the database management is nothing but collection of organized data you're managing. You're creating and you're maintaining that collection of organized data is called as the database management. So to overcome those process, you need a software package that is designed to define, manipulate, retrieve, and manage data in a database is called as the DBMS. Next is RDBMS, that is called as Relational Database Management, where this DBMS is based on the relational model. Relation means you will study now in the last, not last, in the forthcoming slides. So these are some of the terms that you're going to be familiar. That is first, what is data, what is information, what is database management, what is database management system, and RDBMS. Just be very clear with that. It is very simple. Data means raw fact. Information means it is a processed data. Collection of those processed data is called as a database. That database should be maintained. It is called as a database management. You need a software that is called as a DBMS. And that software is based on the relational model means it is called as RDBMS. So these are the examples or applications of a DBMS where it has been applied. For example, banking, telecom, airlines, railways, enterprise information, universities. You will see one by one. So if you're taking the example of banking and finance, it is called as the customer, everything from the top to bottom related to bank, all the data are being managed with the help of DBMS. It may include banking information, it may include credit card transaction, or it may include finance. All the information from top to bottom in banking and finance, it is carried under with the DBMS concept. Similarly, next example comes under telecommunication. For example, if we take a phone company, that is, it may be Airtel, Jio, or BSNL, anything. What are the information they deal is the records of call made, how many calls you're going, a particular person is making to another person, or how many customers are there, and how many employees are there, what is the management record that I have to maintain, how many branches are there, like that management process, and billing information, and switching and wiring diagrams, customer service orders, like this, all the related data related to telecommunication has been managed with the help of DBMS. Next comes the airlines, that is reservations and schedule. That is, if you want to book a railway ticket by using that railway website, or you have to book a ticket in Air India, you have to use this DBMS concept only. Then only you can able to put a reservation, or you can schedule those information. Next comes the enterprise information. Enterprise in the sense business area, wherever the sales, wherever the accounting information, HR information, manufacturing information, online retailers, so all related to business. Business related data are being carried in this enterprise information. Example, if you take accounting, the payment, receipt, account balances, asset, and other accounting information, all the calculations are done with the help of DBMS. And the next last application is in our topic, universities and college. This information you're familiar with, the kinds of information they deal like student records, faculty, management, fees information, college layout, library, mark registers, rank holders, alumni details. All these particular information that the student is familiar is being stored and processed with the help of this DBMS. So with all this data we are having, some questions arise in our mind, like where is the information kept? How is the data structured? How is the data kept consistent? How is the data described? How is the data kept secure? How do different pieces of data interrelated? To all these questions, we have only one single answer, that is the DBMS. DBMS takes care of all those activities. The information storage, data structure, data consistency, data description, data security, data interrelation, everything has been carried out with the help of DBMS. So this is the DBMS structure of a DBMS system. Here comes the user, here are the application storage, DBMS is the central point, and the database storage, and operating system software and hardware. So DBMS acts as an interface between the user and OS software and hardware. So, okay, next is the DBMS software package like Microsoft Access, Visual Fox Pro, Microsoft SQL Server, or Oracle. These are the examples of DBMS software packages, and user developer and implemented database, it may include tables, data dictionary, so on so, and custom applications may be data entry forms, reports, queries, blocks, and programs. And hardware means it may include personal computer, mini computer, mainframe. And software means an operating system and a network operating system. Personal means a particular persons who are going to manage your database. He may be administrator or a designer or an analyst or a programmer and end user. So this slide is the depiction of the diagram. So what the package you use, what the application you use, what is the software you use, and what is the hardware you use are being listed out here. And what is the need or what is the usage of using a DBMS? For example, if you see the diagram, without a DBMS, you have no control, because here the users are using the data. The data may be stored in C++, Java, or PHP, everything. Here the data has been stored as a single file. You have no interrelation or no communication or no control of coordination. How the program is stored, how it can be accessed, how the security rights are given, no control or no coordination exists between this users and this data. But this is a condition that exists when you're using without a DBMS. But at the same time, if you use with the help of a DBMS, you may have a bridge, or you may have a wall like this protecting your data and your particular user. That comes a DBMS that providing the control and coordination to protect the data. This is what the help, main help of DBMS. It provides the control and coordination, main is the protection to secure the data. So next comes the functions of a DBMS. Those are main functions like this, from data dictionary, from manage day-to-day transaction, bookkeeping duties, validation rules, security, backup and recovery, sharing data with data locking capabilities, and provides import and export utilities, enables users to join tables. You will study in the forthcoming units how the tables can be joined. So these are the functions. Next, we will enter into some basic terminologies that exist in the database. The first and foremost is you have to be very clear with a concept called entity. So what does entity means? It is the thing or object that the user records information about it. It is similar to an object that you study in OOPS. That is, whatever the information that the particular data should be recorded in a database, that is represented as an entity. For example, you can see these types of entities. For example, if you want to store information about a person, or a country, or a product, or an order, or a part, or invoice, or customer, or an employee. A person may be an employee or a customer. Your product may include an invoice or a part. Likewise, whatever the particular information you have to deal with, that is called as an entity. That may indicate a thing or it may indicate an object. So next comes the very other important concept is attributes. So what is attributes means? They are the characteristics that describes the entities. For example, if you take in the previous slide, we saw an example called employee. If you take this employee entity, whatever the characteristics that employee entity have is, he may have a name, he may have an age, telephone number, department, likewise. It may include some other data that describe that characteristic of the employee entity. For example, if you are a college student, you may have your student ID number, that is your registration number, your phone number, your birth date. So these are the characteristics that describe about this college student. So this is called as the attributes. These are called as attributes. And next is all the entities collected together, that is collection of entities are collected together is called as an entity set. So this collection of entity set is called as a database, and entities in database interact with other entities is called as a relationships. Interaction link that exists between the entities is called as a relationship. So there are three different categories of relationship in our database. One is one to one, second one is one to many, and third one is many to many. So one to one means, we will see that. Before that, we can say if we want to link data from different tables, we must define relationship between the table. So if you want to take a data from two or more tables, you need a relationship. So whenever you want to exist a relationship, you need a concept called primary key. You will see now in the forthcoming slides about what is a primary key. So one-to-one relationship means it is indicated or it is denoted as one-to-one. This is the definition of one-to-one relationship. You are going to speak in the terms of entity set. So it exists between two entity sets X and Y. If an entity in entity set X has only one matching entity in entity set Y, and vice versa. This is the definition of one-to-one. To be clear, if you take an example, you can say a department in a college has only one chairperson. That is, a department in a college has only one HOD. One HOD heads only one department in a college. This is the example of 1:1. If the college contains a department, the department contains only one HOD, and a person may be a HOD for only one department. He cannot be a HOD for two or three more departments. That relationship is called as one-to-one relationship. Next is one-to-many relationship. One-to-many relationship is denoted by 1:m. It is denoted as 1:m. This is the definition It exists between two sets X and Y. If an entity set X has many matching entities in entity set Y, but an entity in entity set Y has only one matching entity, that is called as the 1:m. This is the example, a faculty teaches for one department in a college, but a department has many faculty members. A particular faculty teaches only one department. This computer science staff belongs to only one computer science department, but a department may contain many faculties. Computer science department may contain 10 faculty members. The relationship between the department and faculty is denoted as 1:m. And next is many to many relationship, that is denoted as m:n or m:m. Example, if a student takes many courses and many students take a course. This is example of m:n or m:m. This is the definition. Just go through. So to determine or to find out the type of relationship that exists, we have to answer these two questions. That is, does an entity in entity set X have more than one matching entity in entity set Y? Does an entity in entity set Y have more than one matching entity in entity set X? If for both these questions, if you receive 1:1 as the answer, that is, if both the question, if you receive the answer as no, that type of relationship is 1:n. For first question is yes, and the second question is no, the relationship will be 1:many. And both the questions, if it is yes, the relationship will be m:n. So next comes the main important is database models. Database models are nothing but they are not at all the database store the data in the same way. It depends on the type of software used. For data models or nothing but they are called as the rules and standards that define how the database organizes the data. So data represented in the logical form has led to many different models. These are the models: relational, hierarchical, network, object oriented. These are the four main important type of database model that exist. One is relational and hierarchical and network and object oriented. We are going to concentrate mainly only on relational data because our syllabus is related to RDBMS and Oracle. R means it denotes relational. So it is of simple design, easy retrieval of data. So that is one of the main reason to become popular in the personal computer environment. Relational database model, whenever you use, it will be of simple design and you can easily retrieve the data. So who denoted or who contributed this relational database model is a researcher called E.F. Code. This person developed this relational database model in 1970. Based on the mathematical set theory, he uses the relation as the building block of the database. So as the name indicates, it is the building block of the database. So that relation is represented by a two-dimensional flat structure known as table. So two-dimensional flat structure known as table. This is the basic or this is the building block of the relational database model is table. The database system that manages the relational database environment is known as RDBMS. What are the examples of RDBMSs? Oracle 99, Microsoft Access 2000 and Microsoft Visual Fox Pro. These are the examples of RDBMS softwares. So next is we have shown that the relation is represented by a two-dimensional flat structure known as table. So how the table will look like means the table is nothing but it is a matrix of rows and columns in which each row represents an entity, each column represents an attribute. If you take an example, if you take a table, likewise, this row, this is the row and this is a column. I think you may understand what is meant by row and what is meant by column. This row is called as entity and this column is denoted as attribute. This how this is a representation of a table. So a table represents an entity set. Before entering into relational database model, we saw what about what it an entity set. That entity set is nothing but it is a table is represented as an entity set. And a table also represents a relation that is called as a relational database theory. These are the in terms that is used interchangeably, but it has the same meaning: table, relation, entity set. both the three have the same meaning. And so here this row, what it indicates an entity, that entity or the row is said to be tuple. And the number of columns in the table is called as a degree. For example, I have only drawn three columns in the table. So that is called as the degree of the relation. Similarly, if a table has four columns, it is said to be degree four. The set of all possible values that a column may have, we call it as domain of the column. So this is the basic terms that is going to be followed in this relational database model. So tables are stored in the form of rows and columns. So each table has a multiple columns and each column has a unique name. Now we will see an example about a student's table. Likewise, the student's table looks like it have a register number, it has a department and it has a name. So this is called as a row. It is called as a column, register number, department name. This has been represented as a column wise. So it is denoted as a column name. And these data are called as the entity that has been denoted as the tuple or row. And these are the attribute column. That is, this entity of Rani, if you take example of entity of Rani is an entity. Rani's characteristics are being represented in the form of attributes that we saw in the previous slide. That is of, she is of the department BBA and her register number is like this. So it denotes as the attributes. So attributes are represented in the column. Table row is represented in the form of tuple. This is the example of how the table looks. So if you take this register number, this department, this name, they're called as a column name. And this individual row, you call it as a tuple. And this individual column, you call it as an attribute. So these are the some of the examples that we cover in our prescribed textbook. It includes like this tables. 2002, 2003, project paths, department, employee. These are the some of the relational database tables that has been given in our prescribed book. The terminology comparison is the entity set or table or relation is called as file, and entity row or tuple is called as the record. Attribute column or column is called as the field. This file, record, field are the terms that you have come across in Access databases. The access of file system terminology and here the relational terminology. It has been compared. So next comes the main important concept is key. Key is nothing but it is a minimal set of columns used to uniquely identify any row in a table. So key means you're going to identification purpose, that is unique identifying any row in a table. If you use a single column, that is called as a primary key. If you use combination of columns, that is called as a composite primary key or composite key. And secondary key means extra column as a primary key means that you called as a surrogate key. So in relational database tables are related to each other through a common column. The common column in a table that reference a column in another table is called as the foreign key. So here the unique identification example is in the previous table what we saw here. Unique identification, we can say register number. So register number may be called as primary key. Because everyone, for example, in your class, if you have, I can't remember the names, I'm sorry. If you have a Anu means two Anus are there means to differentiate, we will use the register number. Likewise, the register number column acts as a unique identifier that is called as a primary key. Likewise, if the register number and the name that both is combined, you call it as a composite primary key. So these are all the notations that is given in our prescribed book. These are the table relation names and these are the column names. So the table name is followed by a list of columns within parentheses. Project 2002 is a table name what we have seen here. It includes a column, project number, location, customer. These three names are given within the bracket. These denotes column names. These are the column names and this is the table name. and whichever it is underlined, it indicates your primary key. This is what called as a primary key. If two primary columns have been underlined, here you use composite primary key because you're combining two keys as a primary key. Next comes the most important concept is integrity rules. What is meant by integrity rules means that, for example, if rules is imposed, the quality will be increased. Likewise, if we follow the integrity rules, you can able to maintain the quality of the data. So there are main two important integrity rules. One you call as entity integrity and second one you call it as referential integrity. Entity integrity and referential integrity. Entity integrity means it is going to be based upon a null value concept. So what is meant by null? Null is nothing but it is a value that is not known, not entered, not defined, not applicable. That is called as the null. The entity integrity rules states that primary key value can't be null. Primary key can't be null. That is, no column in a primary key may be null is the simple rule of entity integrity. That is, primary key means we have shown an example, that is your student register number is a primary key. That primary key should not be null or it should not be empty. That if it applies that rule, that is called as entity integrity rule. For example, why we are saying that it should not be null means because of that primary key value only we are going to identify the individual rows in a table, and if it has a null value then we can't identify those rows. A table can contain a null value other than the primary key field. We will see an example. See here, the register number, department name, the example that we saw in the previous slide, the same example is here denoted here. If you take in this example, the first three rows contains a register number, but in the fourth row, it has an empty field. This is said to be violating an entity integrity rule because the primary key does not appear here. Primary key value cannot be a null value. If it is a null value, we are saying that it violates the entity integrity value. Next is the referential integrity, and referential integrity means it is specified between two tables. That is, it is going to talk about the primary key and foreign key. That is, a foreign key must have a matching primary key is a rule that has been imposed on referential integrity. Reference is nothing but from a table to another table should be valid. That we call as the referential integrity. Example, it is a table called students, and it is a table here called as department. The table students contains register number, department ID, name column, and department table contains department ID and department name. For example, this student table has columns like register number, department and ID name, where this register number is a primary key of this table, and department is another table where the department ID is the primary key for this table. If this department ID, see this department ID is reflecting this department ID at the time when it consists of a key value which does not exist in this primary key table, we can say that it is violating this referential integrity constraint because the relation student does not satisfy this referential integrity constraint because the relation department have no value in primary key specifies this number. This SJC005, this value does not occur in this table. So it is violating the referential integrity constraint. So that's all the two types of constraint. Entity integrity constraint means no primary key value can be null. The primary key is the tuple identifier. Referential integrity constraint means references between relations must be valid. That is, the foreign key of a referencing relation must exist as a primary key in the referenced relation. This is called as the integrity constraint. So that's all. We stop up. As you can now able to view the screen. Question now. as Rafia Parveen, Kirtana, R Kirtana. They have answered two questions. Is Rafia Parveen has answered for all the five questions.
Ma'am.
Yeah, I can able to see, ma'am.
Ma'am, link resend
pannan,
ma'am.
It has been in the chat box, la ma'am. Chat box irukadhu appadi click pannunga.
Ma'am, the meeting la veli vandirchu
ma'am, seriya. Marudi and link click panninga na ulla poidum.
Ma'am, chat box la and link delete aichu ma'am, adu varali.
ஓ அப்படி சொல்றியா ரைட் ரைட்
தேங்க்யூ மேம்